been the one to doubt your love. And I told myself you're not in love.
All overcome by my own sin. I've been the one to fall apart and start to question who you are.
You're the one who conquers giants. You're the one who calls out kings. You shake the mouths of lions. You tell the dead to breathe. You're the one.
So I don't need to say that my name is Ethan and I'm the pastor here tonight. Before we get going, I wanted to point out a couple of things about what we're up to. But first, just ask this question. Do you know why we exist as a church? Is there a main reason that we are here and that we do all the things that we do? That reason is to glorify God, to display the glory of God. And we do that in particular ways. So one way we do that is when we, three main ways actually. One way is when we gather for worship every Sunday. That's one way we glorify God, is we sing his praises, we fellowship with one another, we hear his word. A second way we glorify God is in our fellowship with one another. Apostle John talks about this all over 1 John. Your love for one another will display to the world the glory of God. And so when you interact with each other, not just on Sundays, but throughout the week, you're showing the world the glories of God that has brought you together with this other person with the miraculous love that most people don't ever know and experience in this life. And then a third way we glorify God is when we serve. We love our neighbor and we serve the lost. We think about our community in general and want to love and support them. So here's some things that we're doing in the next few weeks that are going to be hitting up these different buckets of how we glorify God together as a church. Tonight, after service, we're going to be decorating the church for Christmas, and we're going to be having just a light dinner of soup and salad. So if you'd like to join us, please do. And that's going to set us up for the Advent season, the next few weeks together on Sundays. We're going to be putting together a church directory. We're going to update it. Now, this is actually a means for you to connect with other people. So this is working towards that purpose of our fellowship. If you'd like to be put in the church directory, you can fill out a yellow card that's in the back table and just drop it in the offering plate. And then Catherine will also be in the back to take your photo. So she's got a photo studio set up in the nursery. And she'll quickly just snap her photo. She got a brand new phone. It takes really nice photos. But it'll be your one-stop shop to get updated for our church directory. One way we're serving our neighbor is in our winter clothing drive. We've already gathered so much in just this first Sunday of collecting things. But a few houses down the street right here is a sober house for women that Lana runs. Lana is one of the NA group leaders that meets in our church. And she bought this house and just started renting it out for women. And she's got this robust system of rules and standards and process for helping women stay in the house and be able to recover and then transition out. But while they're there, they often come with nothing. And so she's suited out her entire basement with all sorts of things from toiletries to clothing. And when I was able to tour this house and see, she said that they were super, super low on winter clothing items. And so we're just going to surprise them and give them a big Christmas gift and collect winter clothing items for women. That's what we're doing in the back. So if you have new or lightly used clothes for women, please bring them to church over the next couple Sundays. And then we're going to be giving them over to her as our Christmas gift as a church to love our neighbor. And then a couple other things here. Our fall cleanup is coming up. This is going to be on a Saturday, December 10th, in a couple weeks. There's a short laundry list of things, but if you have any tools or anything that you use for lawn care or cleaning up your house, bring them. Main thing that we're going to be doing is just taking away the leaves and putting them in the woods. So if you have rakes or tarps, that's the kind of thing that we're looking for. But there's some other little projects that certain people will be doing as well that you could be part of. Maybe this is the last one, I'm not sure. But ladies' Christmas brunch, this is a time for fellowship for the women. And it's going to be, is it the same Saturday? Or no, the Saturday after that. The Saturday after the fall cleanup. The women are going to be gathering here in the church with Catherine and other ladies to have a time of fellowship together to celebrate Christmas and celebrate Christ's coming, celebrate our relationships that God has given us with one another. And as always, you can give. We really appreciate all the giving that comes through the church, especially in this time when oil prices are going way up. This is just a practical matter, and God is very gracious to provide for us through generous people like you. So thank you for giving. You can give in the offering plates in the back. You can also sign up and give online, and that can be even recurring, so you don't need to think about it every week. We're going to keep these slides going, so if you missed any dates or anything, you can see them again. But for now, let's put all of this aside. Let's put all of this aside and think about the one reason why we're here, and that's to worship God, to bask in the light of his glory, and to see what he might do with us when we worship him together. So let's just take a few moments now to be quiet before the Lord as we prepare our hearts to worship him together.
Please stand with me as I read our call to worship, found in Psalm 100, verses 1 to 3. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture.
I heard somebody give a talk one time on the opposite of love. What's the first thing that pops in your mind when you think of the opposite of love? Hate, right? The sermon was how the opposite of love is actually fear. And he actually did a pretty good job of unpacking that. The fact that when we're not loving, we're living in an atmosphere of just fear itself. And he used that verse that says, perfect love actually drives out fear. This song is a great song to remind us that whatever it is, maybe you're just anxious about Monday morning, what's going to happen this week. Maybe you're anxious about things that are lying ahead with the holidays. Maybe you're anxious about just your work, relationships in your life. Whatever it is, there's a great question here that comes from Scripture. Whom shall I fear? Who do we have to be afraid of when God is on our side?
You hear me when I call, you are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Your troubles linger still. Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me, and I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. My strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will deliver me, yours is the victory. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me, and I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. I know who goes before me, and I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. always by my side.
Father, we thank you for the truth of those words, and that though many things in this world tempt us to fear and to succumb to just the temptation to take our eyes off of you and to put them on the waves that are splashing all around us. Lord, forgive us for the ways that we've done that this past week. We ask that you would reorient our thinking, reorient our minds and our hearts, because when you are on our side, there is no battle that's going to be a draw. When you're on our side, there is no circumstance that is going to overwhelm us. And we put our trust and our faith in you. Lord, we have a guaranteed outcome. Lord, we've read the end of the book. And the end of the book is that Jesus wins. Because you are sovereign over all things. We place our lives in your care. We thank you for your love for us.
Perfect in love.
Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity to gather together as your people. You always do so much more with us when we gather here than what we were thinking. And it's such a blessing to see everyone again, to hear your word, to declare your praises, and now to come before you with our requests. Not only to give you our burdens, but to bear one another's burdens. I want to thank you so much for just the situation with Sue's sister, how dark and bleak it can be, and yet you're still shining light into their life and giving them hope. And I pray that her improved speech can continue to improve, and they might be able to find other praises and improvements along the way through this hard time. I pray for Shirley's family member, daughter-in-law Brenda's sister, who passed away, that you would comfort the family. You would be around them in this time. We thank you that they're close here on the Cape, that they can be around people like Shirley. May you lift them up in this trying time for them. I pray for Nakia's neighbor, Wade. We thank you that he's a Christian. We thank you that they have this fellowship together in Christ. And I pray for his eye surgery, that it goes well, that you give him hope, that you show him your care for him, even in this fallen world where our bodies are decaying, Lord. I pray for Agnes's new employee that was hit by a car. Please sustain his health and help him to recover. I pray that Agnes would be a light for the gospel in his life in this hard time, when he's asking big questions about life, having a lot of time to think. Would you just help him recover? Give the doctors wisdom and guidance as they care for him. And pray for Mark's family, who recently passed away, leaving a young daughter behind. There can be so many questions and so few answers in this kind of moment, but I pray that you would bring them along by your Spirit, Lord, and maybe Jeff and other people that they know who are close to you can be an encouraging word for them. I pray that they would have people around them to just sit and listen and be present with them as they grieve. And may this prayer now be effective to bring change and hope and encouragement despite such despair. And we praise you for Janet Gage. We thank you so much that we get to be part of her life, and you've let us be a part of her life. We thank you that we get to just glean these rays of sunshine that radiate off her life, and we can be warmed by them ourselves. We thank you for sustaining her life for these many decades now, and for her ability to continue to praise you with such gratitude and grace. May we learn from this example. Would you make us more like Janet? We thank you for her and for her faithfulness to you and to your people here at Forestdale Church. In Jesus' name, we lift up all these people. Amen. Thank you for sharing. Our scripture reading is in Psalm chapter 3. This is the final sermon of our series going through the Lord's Prayer. Every Sunday we've looked at a different line of the Lord's Prayer. There are five lines of the Lord's Prayer. And we've seen how particular psalms teach us how to pray these lines of the Lord's Prayer. The last line here that we're at is that the Lord taught us to pray is, "Lead us not into temptation, Father, but deliver us from evil." And David is writing this, as you see in the prescript, when he fled from Absalom, his son. We'll get into this in a moment. But let us look now at God's word and see how Psalm 3 teaches us how to pray. It says, a psalm of David when he fled from his son, Absalom. Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. But you, Lord, are a shield around me, my glory, the one who lifts my head. I call out to the Lord, and he answers me from his holy mountain. I lie down and sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear, though 10,000s assail me on every side. Arise, Lord, deliver me, my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw. Break the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be on your people. So, as I said, we've been looking at this prayer, the Lord's Prayer, as a model prayer. This should guide and direct all of our prayers, these five lines here. We've seen how that we should begin our prayers adoring God, forgetting about us, forgetting about our needs, and just adoring God, who he is, saying, hallowed be your name. And then we're to pray that we become aligned with God's will, praying, God, may your will be done in my life and not my own. And then we pray for our daily needs, like even daily bread, needs great and small. We pray to confess our sin as we forgive those who sin against us. And now finally, this request for protection from trials and deliverance when we come underneath these trials. Now we first think of this word temptation in reference to being enticed to sin. But there's a second word, second way that this Greek word for temptation can be used, and it is to refer to a trial or a test. Like when a car manufacturer would put a new car through a crash test to see if there's anything else they need to do with this car to help its performance and its safety. They need to make any adjustments here. It's a test to see. The Apostle James uses the same word in this kind of trial sort of way when he says, blessed is the one who endures trials. In Matthew, it's temptations, but it's in James, it's trials. So when Jesus taught us to pray, lead us not into temptation, it's probably more likely that he is referring to a trial being endured. Lord, do not lead us into trials that we will have to endure. Rather than praying that we would, Lord, pray that you won't tempt us to sin. We know that the Lord does not tempt us to sin, as the Apostle James says. But especially when we think about what comes next, what's the answer to this prayer? Don't lead us into temptation, but what? Deliver us from evil. So evil and temptations are working as a parallel together in this petition. Rather than leading us into trials, Lord, would you deliver us? We remember the testing that Job went through. The Lord and the devil were debating what type of man they thought Job was, what kind of character he had. So the devil proposes a test. The Lord agrees to allow the devil to test Job. And in time, Job shows himself to be a man of integrity after all. So we are praying, Father, please don't put us through a Job experience. When we're praying, Lord, lead us not into temptation. This is what it means. But do you find it strange that the Lord put this in his model prayer that he taught his disciples? Do you find it strange, or does it come natural to you to pray this every day? We know that we need daily bread, so we pray for it every day. And I guess if we are honest, we would admit that as often as we need bread, we need to confess our sins too. But do we really need to pray for deliverance from evil so often as a habit of our prayer life? Well, I don't know what your ideas about the Christian life are, or what you may have heard other preachers or other churches say about what our life in this life is as Christians, as followers of Jesus. But when we look at Scripture, it is very clear. If you're going to follow Jesus, you're going to follow him into suffering. It's as if suffering were an identity of the Christian life this side of heaven. One theologian I was reading about this subject said that there's nothing more basic to the identity of the church in the New Testament than a church that, quote, suffers with Christ. Consider John 15, what Jesus said. If you were of the world would love you. But because you're not, but rather I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. Or remember 2 Timothy. Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will live a victorious life. No, will be persecuted. Or 1 Peter, dear friends, don't be surprised at the fiery ordeals that come upon you to test you as though something strange were happening. This is not strange. This is normal according to the New Testament. Now, there are times when we may experience great suffering as a Christian. Yet, even when it seems like we're not, even when it seems like things are going just fine, there actually are still battles that need to be fought in other ways that you may not even realize, and we'll see that in a minute. This is why we need to regularly pray for the Lord not to lead us through temptations and trials, but rather to deliver us. This needs to be a habit of our prayer life, because it is our identity as followers of Jesus this side of heaven. Praying this prayer regularly keeps us sober-minded to that reality. And yet, despite that reality, we have hope because of what we see here in Psalm 3. That because God is in control and is committed to his people, we can call on him for deliverance. We can call on him in confidence that he will deliver us. Well, as the prescript of the psalm tells us, this was David's own prayer, Psalm 3, when he was fleeing from his son Absalom. We read about this in 2 Samuel chapter 15 verses through chapter 17. Now, at this point in David's life, when he's praying this prayer, he's an old man. He's at the back end of his time as king. Maybe he's 86 or something like that. His son Absalom has grown up. He's strong now. And he's conspiring against his father to take the throne. He asks his father, could I go out to another city to make sacrifices to the Lord? David grants this request, but what Absalom goes to do, strangely, he does ask for sacrifices to the Lord, but he's trying to assemble men to rise up and anoint him as king instead of David. So David means this literally in verse 1 when he says, Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? David is losing loyal followers left and right to his son Absalom, who is gaining them from every side. How many adversaries do you have in the Christian life? When Jesus tells his disciples to pray for deliverance, what kind of trials do you think Jesus has in mind that we need to be praying for as a habit of our life? Well, in Scripture, we find three primary sources of suffering for the Christian life. Three different reasons why you may need to be praying, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. First, the world. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, blessed are you when people insult you, when people persecute you and falsely say all kinds of things against you. Here's the key: because of me, on account of me. So Jesus is not referring to just a general mistreatment you might receive from another person, but being mistreated because you are following Jesus. The Apostle Paul wrote often about the mistreatment that he endured as an apostle of Jesus Christ. Throughout church history, you can find a history of mistreatment and persecution from the world on individuals and groups. Even governing authorities coming down to persecute God's people because they follow Jesus and are obeying what he'd said. Even today, there's still great persecution that happens to Christians in Kenya, Pakistan, China, many other countries. Churches today are bombed. Christians are imprisoned, and some are even killed. Yet even if you and I don't experience this type of persecution from the world, you still may be mistreated because you follow Christ. Perhaps by someone in your family, someone at work, someone who knows you and knows that you're a Christian, remember the words of Jesus, is that if they persecuted me, they will persecute you. And when it comes to this topic of suffering, typically the conversation stops here. When we've discussed persecution from the world, right? But Scripture paints a much broader picture of suffering than simply persecution from the world. So here's a second source of suffering. It's the flesh. And it can be shorthand in Scripture for our sinful nature, not our bodies. This is not some sort of New Age spirituality where we need to gravitate out of our bodies and into the higher being of the soul. No. The way Scripture uses this, the flesh, is shorthand for our sinful nature. The Apostle Paul writes in Romans 8, I consider, he says, that our present sufferings are not worthy of being compared to the glory that's going to be revealed to us. But what kind of suffering has he been talking about this whole time in Romans 8? Well, up to this point, from Romans 6 through Romans 8, he's referring to the battle between our sin nature and our new nature in Christ. He writes, don't walk in step with your old nature, which is after the pattern of Adam, but walk in the Spirit according to your new nature, which has been given in Christ. This process is often referred to as sanctification. We're called to wage war against our sinful nature, our flesh, if you will, every day until the day of our redemption in Christ when we are raised incorruptibly pure. So praying regularly for the Lord to deliver us from this kind of evil keeps us vigilant, lest that we be caught suddenly in sin. But a third source of suffering, the devil. The devil. This source of suffering can also be referred to as spiritual warfare in a more general sense. There may be lots of theories and mystery about how we are persecuted in spiritual warfare, but here are some things that Scripture does say about this. It says, when Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead, he disarmed these rulers and authorities, Colossians 2:15. God raised Jesus to power above these spiritual authorities and place them under his feet, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 20 and 22, where Jesus is trampling them out until they are finally defeated, 1 Corinthians 15:25. And for those of us who are in Christ, we have been transferred from being under Satan's dominion and put into the dominion of King Jesus, God's Son, Colossians 1:13. And we are empowered by the Holy Spirit to live under King Jesus' reign, despite present suffering, Romans 8:9. Yet we are called to stand vigilant all the same. Despite Christ's present victory and the Holy Spirit's empowering our lives, we're still called to be vigilant against the devil and spiritual warfare until Christ's work of redemption is complete in us. The Apostle Peter writes to the church, be alert, be sober-minded. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. So resist him. Stand firm in the faith because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And there's a mysterious way that spiritual warfare may contribute to the suffering that we experience in this life. And sometimes it feels like it's working right along with persecution from the world or our own sin natures that still are covering us. So now we can kind of relate maybe to Psalm verse 3, verse 1. How many are my foes? We see there's a battle that's outside of us from the world. You see, there's a battle going inside of us against our sin nature. And there's a battle that's transcendent all around us in spiritual warfare. How much more can you feel now? David's cry to God, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Is there any comfort for us here and now, despite this reality? Is there any confidence that we can be given? Is there any reason to think that we can remain steadfast in our faith, let alone grow in our faith, with such opposition? Is there any way that we could pray like David does in verse 6, this big turnaround? He says, I will not fear, though 10,000s assail me on every side. What brings David to such radical confidence? For however many are his foes that are around him, in this psalm, he prays about three pillars of defense that the Lord gives. Three pillars of defense. First, we see him pray about God's presence. He writes in verses 3 and 4, "You, Lord, are a shield around me, my glory, the one who lifts my head. I call out to the Lord, and he answers me from his holy mountain." Now, David knows he can always call out to God in prayer, and that when he calls out to God, God will always hear him. Why? Because David has the right to be heard. Because God made a covenant with David as king. We read about this in 2 Samuel 7. God made a covenant with David to preserve him as king and to establish his throne and his family line for eternity. What about us? As the church, we also have a right to request deliverance from God. Because of God's new covenant that he established with Christ, which was ratified by Christ in his death and was sealed to us when we received the Holy Spirit, making God our Father. So God is a shield even around us on every side, and he always hears us when we call out to him because he bound himself to us by a covenant through Christ, and he is ever present with us by his Holy Spirit. We know the redemptive storyline. Before Jesus ascended into heaven, he told his disciples that he would send his Holy Spirit to comfort and guide them. And we read in Acts 2 about the outpouring of the Spirit. When the disciples were gathered together in Jerusalem during the Feast of Pentecost. But what the disciples start to learn is that it turns out everyone who comes to faith in Christ also receives this Holy Spirit. Paul writes in Romans chapter 8 again, "The Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you." Then a few verses later, "The Spirit we've received brought us into adoption as God's children, by whom we cry out to God as our Father." And then further down in Romans 8, "The Spirit helps us in our weaknesses when we don't even know what to pray, by interceding to the Father on our behalf." This is why we today can pray to God, and why God always hears us when we pray. This is our comfort despite great trials in our faith. God always hears us when we call because he has bound himself to us by a covenant that he made with Christ his Son and is ever present with us by his Holy Spirit. So, whether you are being persecuted by the world, whether you're afflicted in your sinful nature, or spiritually oppressed by the devil himself, call out to the Lord and find comfort in his presence. Because if you're in Christ, Psalm 3 verse 4 is always true for you. "I call out to the Lord and he answers me." In verse 5, we see a second pillar of our defense, God's providence. A couple days ago, I just came across a video of online about rock climbers bolting ropes into the side of a cliff, bolting themselves to the cliff, and then unfolding a sleeping bag and taking a nap. I was terrified watching that video. And I was wondering, and I thought for a second, what is going on inside of their brain? How could somebody come to a point mentally where they could sleep? And either they're crazy or they have so much confidence when they see just the matter of factness of what is happening. Their bolts are in the right way. Their rope is strong and secure. Everything is in place. Therefore, they believe it is impossible for me to fall. That's how they can sleep. They believe it is impossible for them to fall. Some mountain climbers can sleep on a side of a cliff, but what makes a Christian able to sleep underneath great persecution? David writes in verse 5, I lie down and sleep. I wake again. Why? He says, because the Lord sustains me. He's talking about the providence of God, the fact that God is absolutely in control. Acts 17:25, the Lord gives all people their life and breath and everything. David has enough peace to lie down and sleep in the midst of great persecution because he knows the Lord is absolutely in control whatever comes his way. We saw this in detail last Sunday looking at Psalm 104, God's absolute control. Because he created the world, he is actively sustaining the world, and he is committed to renew the world. The doctrine of this providence, the providence of God, is found in Scripture from cover to cover. And it has given incredible confidence to missionaries serving in the most dangerous places of the world. For example, Henry Martin, missionary to India and Persia in the early 1800s. He died when he was 31. My age, when he was 31, he died as a missionary. But this is what he wrote in his journal just 10 months before he died. He said, to all appearance, the present year is going to be more serious than anything I've ever seen. But if I live to complete the Persian New Testament, something he was translating, my life after that will be of less importance. But whether life or death be mine, may Christ be magnified in me. Here it is. If he has worked for me to do, I cannot die. This is our confidence. God is absolutely in control. Do you believe that about your life? If God is the author of my life, then he's the author of my enemy's life. And if he has work for me to do in this side of heaven, I cannot die. So whether you are being persecuted by the world, whether you are under affliction because of your own sinful nature, battling it, or whether you are under the spiritual oppression of the devil himself, call out to the Lord, find confidence in his providence. Because if God wants you to wake up tomorrow morning, you will. And if God has work for you to do, there is nothing the world, the flesh, or the devil can say about it. Why? What could make us so confident? Well, here's how the Apostle Paul answers that. Because he who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it. The Lord not only hears us when we call out to him, but he sustains us by his providence. Now, the third and final pillar of defense we see in Psalm 5 is God's deliverance. God's deliverance. He is completely committed to our deliverance. Deliverance is the theme of this passage. It began in verse 2 with David's enemies. They're the ones who brought it up. They said, there's no deliverance coming for him from God. But then it comes up again as David calls for God to deliver him in verse 7 and a final time in verse 8 with David's renewed confidence that deliverance belongs to the Lord. This is the same word for salvation. So that you have a parallel verse in Jonah. You know this verse? Salvation belongs to the Lord. That's what Jonah says. That's what David says here in verse 8. But can we be as confident? Can we be so sure? Or are we as Christians left to blind faith or positive thinking? Is our faith in God just simply something we've made up to make ourselves feel better because of how difficult life can be? Or are there actual reasons why we believe what we believe? Is there any reason for you to believe what God's word says over you instead of what your enemies are saying over you? Yes, there is, and we've seen a preview of this already, of how God will deliver us when we've seen how God delivered his own son, Jesus Christ. Jesus endured sufferings of all kinds, just as the apostle, or as the writer of Hebrews says, that Jesus was tempted in every way as we are, yet without sin. We know Jesus was tempted by the devil in the wilderness for 40 days. Jesus was ridiculed and he was mocked by people around him. He was rejected by his own family. He was persecuted and ultimately crucified on a cross for being the Son of God. Now, it would have seemed to everyone watching that both his earthly and his spiritual enemies have all won and defeated him. Yet in his dying breath, Jesus says to God his Father, "Into your hands I commit my spirit." He's confessing, "My life is still in your hands. Even in death, you will sustain me." Perhaps while hanging on the cross, he remembered Psalm 3, verse 5. "I lie down and I sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me." Or maybe Psalm 16, verse 10. "You will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful one see decay." God the Father was committed to his Son, and he vindicated him from all the suffering that he faced and the persecution he received by raising Jesus from the dead, incorruptible. The Apostle Peter tells a crowd of witnesses the day that the Holy Spirit was poured out. He says that David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah in that he was not abandoned to the realm of the dead, nor did his body see decay. But God raised this Jesus to life, and we, the apostles, are all witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit, and he has poured him out in what you see and hear today. So know this, that when we at Forestdale Church talk about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we are not talking about fables or fairy tales. We're talking about history. This is what we are basing our present faith on and putting our future hope in, the resurrection. The Holy Spirit shows us that God's own commitment to deliver Jesus is actually the same commitment he gives to deliver you. Back to Romans 8, verses 11. I've already read part of this verse, that the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you. Now here's the rest. And if the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, then he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his Spirit who lives in you. So Paul concludes this part of his letter in Romans with these astounding words. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who could be against us? He didn't spare his own son, but he gave him up for us all. How will he not also, along with Christ, graciously give us who are in Christ all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? Because it's God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who then will separate us from the love of God? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake, we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced, Paul writes, that neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. This sure hope emboldens us as believers, despite how many foes rise against us. God's commitment to us through his own Son, who has united us to himself and sealed us by the Holy Spirit. And this sure hope emboldened another missionary, this one from the late 1800s. This missionary was determined to go to the islands in the South Pacific to bring the gospel for the first time to an island of cannibal people. This missionary was John Patton. And he wrote in his journal, he said, "Amongst those who sought to deter me was one dear old Christian gentleman whose crowning argument was this: the cannibals, you'll be eaten by the cannibals." But John Patton replied to the man like this. He says, "Mr. Dixon, you are advanced in years now, and your own prospect is soon to be laid in the grave, there to be eaten by worms. If I can live and die serving and honoring the Lord Jesus, it will make no difference to me whether I am eaten by cannibals or by worms. And in the great day, my resurrection body will rise just as fair as yours, in the likeness of our risen Savior." Isn't that incredible? How could you pray like that? Get Psalm 3 in your blood. The Lord not only hears us when we call out to him, he not only sustains us by his providence, but he assures us of our deliverance in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So, whether you are being persecuted by the world, whether you're being afflicted in your sinful nature, or whether you are being oppressed by the devil himself, look back to the resurrection of Jesus and be renewed as you look forward in hope to the day of the Lord. When all of the Lord's enemies will be finally vanquished, when your sinful nature will finally shed off like an insect's molting skin, and when the devil will be cast and bound in eternal judgment, look forward to this day, the day of the Lord. Because God is in control and committed to deliver his people. Therefore, we can call on him in confidence. Just as these things caused David to double down on his faith in God's deliverance, so they should strengthen us in our faith here and now. And my desire is that these truths shape us as Christians and shape us in our reputation as a church to our community. Because God is committed to our deliverance, we can live with peace despite present suffering. We can endure trials with patience. We can display a curious confidence which can only make sense to the world when we talk about Jesus. May that be true for us. Let us pray. Father, we thank you so much for your word again, how it just turns us around, flips us over, sets us on new ground to walk again renewed by the truth of what you say. May we be so rooted in Scripture, we can pray these prayers as our own. We thank you again for your word. We thank you for Christ, for his work on the cross. We thank you for your Spirit, uniting us to yourself, so that you can be always present with us while we wait for this day of redemption. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Say it as well when my voice can barely speak, and how can I sing you a song in the midst of suffering? Jesus, will you meet me here? Let your peace wash over me. Now more than ever, teach my soul to sing. My God is still in control, and still he reigns on his throne. Though mountains may tremble,
Staying to help clean up. We want to thank you in advance for staying. And for all of us as we go home tonight, would you know that you're going home with God's blessing over you? You're not going out to chance. You're going with God still with you. This comes from Numbers chapter 6. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. You're dismissed.